I'm Kara Holsapple, and this is Trump on Earth. Science is supposed to be impartial. There's a trusted method for collecting and analyzing data to test hypotheses. Scientific studies are the foundation for public health and environmental policies. But the Trump administration has not heeded the science when it comes to climate change. And the Environmental Protection Agency is moving ahead with a controversial rule to limit the use of scientific studies that don't make underlying data public when writing or revising public health and environmental policies. A 30-day public comment period opened March 3rd, and EPA administrators aim to have the rule finalized by May. But science has been undermined by industry and corporate interests for years, way before the Trump administration, and with dire consequences. David Michaels has been studying this phenomenon for a long time. He's an epidemiologist and professor at George Washington University. He's also former Assistant Secretary of Labor for the Occupational Safety and Health Administration under President Obama, and worked in the Clinton administration as Assistant Secretary for Environment, Safety, and Health at the Department of Energy. Now he's the author of The Triumph of Doubt, Dark Money and the Science of Deception. We had a chance recently to talk about his new book. So first, I just want to say thanks for taking the time to talk with me.
My pleasure.
So in the book, you look at a number of examples of industries or corporations trying to influence public opinion and policy for products or byproducts that have potentially pretty dangerous impacts on public health, like PFAS chemicals, diesel exhaust, opioids. And they do that by manufacturing doubt about the scientific studies that show us why these things are harmful. First, could you describe how you started down this road of looking into misinformation campaigns and the situation that you faced with nuclear workers exposed to beryllium, which is a metal that's toxic to people, as the Assistant Secretary for Environment, Safety, and Health at the Department of Energy under the Clinton administration?
We had hundreds of workers who had been made sick by exposure to beryllium, and they get a disease called chronic beryllium disease. There's not really much question about it. And we were moving to issue a regulation to protect workers across the weapons complex. The beryllium industry was very concerned. They didn't want more regulation, especially in the private sector, which wouldn't even be covered by the regulation I was putting out. But I read a number of reports that they issued. They hired scientists to say the evidence just isn't clear enough. You know, we don't really understand how beryllium causes beryllium disease. Is it breathing it, or do you have to worry about skin contact as well? We really need several more years of research before we can do anything. Of course, I looked at that and said, well, that's crazy. You don't wait for more research. You protect people on the basis of the best available evidence. And when I started to pull the string on that, I saw that there are a number of consulting companies whose businesses provide clients, corporate clients, with reports and studies that manufacture uncertainty. I saw memos from Hill and Knowlton and public relations firms saying, you know, we've helped other industries stop government agencies or slow them down, and this is how we can do that. And that intrigued me, and I could tell it was the tobacco model. And when I started pursuing it, I saw that not just the beryllium industries, but many industries were taking, essentially pursuing the what we call the tobacco playbook, and using even the same scientists who worked for tobacco to do this sort of work. And that intrigued me, and I've been writing about it really since then, which is the early 2000s. I took a break when I ran the Occupational Safety and Health Administration, but then when I left to go back to George Washington University, I could see that that had become even more widespread. And in fact, some of the same scientists who I had been studying, who were trying to influence the government from the outside, now were being given prominent positions in the Trump administration. This really is the triumph of doubt, and that's why I decided to write the book.
Yeah, you say that this corporate practice of sowing doubt in science started with the tobacco industry decades ago, and its development of something called product defense. And you say the tobacco industry's motto was, doubt is our product. What is product defense?
Product defense is essentially this idea. It really comes out of the criminal justice system, the idea that people are innocent until they're proven guilty. And what attorneys do, of course, is they will represent people in court and try to show that they're not guilty. Not necessarily that they're innocent, but to put holes in a prosecution that says that they're guilty. So the scientists and the lawyers who work for product defense look at chemicals and other hazards the same way that the criminal justice system looks at people. It says, well, you know, we can stop regulation. We can cause enough confusion. We can essentially raise questions enough that people will say these chemicals aren't guilty. So these are scientists whose job it is to defend products. And, you know, they're businesses, and their business model, of course, is to provide exactly what their clients need. So you can always predict exactly what the scientists will say. They'll say the evidence isn't there to regulate this product, to protect people from this product.
Yeah, what are some of the tools of this product defense industry?
One I find that I like to look at a lot are what I call mercenary reanalyses. I'm an epidemiologist. You do a study, you sort of design the study, you put out your methods, and then you follow those methods and you see what result you get. What industry does is they demand the raw data from an epidemiologic study, and they can reanalyze it by changing assumptions, by changing the cut points. There are lots of tricks of the trade, and you could turn a positive study into one that's negative. And then all of a sudden you have these two studies. They say, well, look, we have opposite studies, opposite conclusions, and people throw their hands up and say, well, what do we really know? It's an unfortunate device, because to take a study that's already been done and reanalyze it to find a different result isn't the same validity as the study you did in the first place.
You call these scientists who work for these PR campaigns and that are hired by industry and rich individuals mercenary scientists. Why would a scientist do that?
You know, I think there are lots of reasons. I think there are some who come in with certain skepticism. They want to question everything. It's just in their personality. Some have political goals. But mostly, once you start getting paid for something, you buy into it. You know, you see things certain ways. And there are some examples of that, which I talk about in the book, where even well-regarded scientists, academic scientists, who are just consultants to corporations, they're given some data to look at. They see it wrong. They get it totally wrong. And we know that because the truth comes out shortly thereafter when another study shows that it's definitive what the answer is. But because they had a financial relationship with a company, it influenced unconsciously the way they looked at the data. You know, the famous author Upton Sinclair, who wrote The Jungle, said, "It's difficult to get a man to believe something when his salary depends on him not believing it." And I think that's what goes on in many cases. You get into the system and you get paid. And to keep staying in that system, to keep getting paid, you look at the world a certain way.
So dark money and these kind of campaigns of misinformation are often revealed much later by lawsuits or gaffes made by corporations. How does the system need to change so that corporate money doesn't have this outside influence on scientific studies for things like environmental toxins, lead and chemicals, and how they're eventually regulated?
Well, let me give you an example. It's a great question. We need to understand what the long-term health effects are of e-cigarettes. You know, we know combustible cigarettes are really dangerous. It's great to get people off of them, and to move to vaping or e-cigarettes probably is a great advance, but we don't really understand the actual long-term effects of pulling a mixture of oils and nicotine and flavors into your lungs, then expelling it. To get that research done, we wouldn't trust the tobacco industry after the long history of tobacco, you know, prevarications around science. But who's going to do that research? So I think for all of these toxins, what we need to do is set up a system where the producer pays for the research, because the research has to be done, but it's done through a system where they don't control which scientists are chosen to do the research, what the methods are, and how the results get interpreted. And that way we can really trust the integrity of the science that we need to protect ourselves.
You write that President Trump's denial of climate science and the distrust of scientists and scientific evidence in his administration are not unique, but cut from the same cloth as the past 50 years of Republican policy, where corporate capitalism is pitted against science and intellectualism. What do you mean by that?
The tobacco industry and then the fossil fuel industry have poured tons of money into both Republican politicians, but also these front groups, the Tea Party groups, that claim that, you know, the government is a nanny state that's trying to, you know, control our lives. And of course, you can only say that if You could also say that the things the government's trying to do are unnecessary. And so the tobacco companies wanted these groups to say that cigarette smoking is not really a problem. The fossil fuel industry wants to say that, you know, greenhouse gases are not really a problem. But what's happened is this has gone on for so long, and so many Republicans have embraced it, particularly because the fossil fuel industry has been pouring money into Republican campaigns. And so Republican senators, for example, no longer have to beg their constituents for campaign support. They can just get all the money they want from a couple of these big corporations. You buy into it, it becomes part of your DNA. And then once that's the case, then you think that people who are raising these issues are wrong. And
people like you.
Right. And I actually had an experience like that recently. You know, I ran OSHA for more than 7 years. I probably know more about OSHA than most anybody in the country. I've gone back to being a professor at George Washington University. So I was asked to testify at a congressional hearing about OSHA. And the panel was three lobbyists or people from industries and me, who had run OSHA for quite a long time. One of the Republican congressmen, this fellow named Glenn Grothman from Wisconsin, walked into the room and he looked at the panel and he said, "Oh, the Democrats, they've invited another professor. Like, how could I really know anything about OSHA?" That was his instinct. We're seeing a lot of that, this idea that, you know, public health scientists can't really know anything, because if we knew anything, then, you know, you'd have some responsibility to address the problems that we're raising.
So how does doubt about the efficacy and intention of science play out in a moment like we're experiencing now with this viral pandemic, where public health and millions of lives depend on good science and trusting scientists?
You know, because this anti-science, anti-intellectualism has become part of the Republican DNA, and we see it not just in the White House, but on Fox News and Rush Limbaugh, and there's a whole echo chamber out there. When public health scientists started raising this issue, I think President Trump had other reasons. He said, "Well, I don't want to make this a big issue. It'll look bad for me. If this gets out of control, it'll look like I have poor leadership." And so he announced that this was a problem that was in control. We had 15 cases of coronavirus. It's going to go down to zero. Nothing's going to happen. And everybody just sort of bought into that because they're used to discarding or rejecting concerns raised by people like me and the epidemiologists around the country. It's easy to do that if you've been doing this for a long time and the Republican base believes President Trump and they believe Fox News. And it delayed a response for almost 2 months, where we could have really moved quickly to address this problem and we would have had things much more under control. We'd still have an epidemic. But if you look at the epidemic in Korea, for example, or Singapore, where they immediately got on the case and they used all of their resources to track cases and develop a testing program, they flattened their epidemiologic curve much more quickly than we haven't flattened ours at all yet. And we will pay a huge price in terms of deaths of people, the overwhelming of our healthcare system. You know, I say a little bit in jest, we're fortunate that the coronavirus doesn't have a lobbyist, because if they were actively lobbying like the lead industry does or the fossil fuel industry does, it would have taken even longer for the government to come around and saying, yes, this is a real problem.
Do you think this erosion of trust in science has trickled down to the general public? Are people cynical about science?
The polls seem to say so, that for many years, scientists were considered among the most trusted groups in America. And that's decreased a little bit, not as much as a lot of other occupations, but certainly gone down. But this idea that scientists can't agree and therefore they're conflicted or they have their own vested interest, you know, is a problem, because sometimes that's the case right now, because scientists are paid to say certain things. Reporters actually and the media play a role in this as well, because they allow this confusion. You know, for many years, well-meaning reporters always said, well, there's two sides to every story. If a scientist is reporting a study, we'll find someone who doesn't agree. And they'll find, often with the help of public relations firms working for these corporations, a corporate scientist who will say, no, the evidence isn't there, or something that's on the opposite side. So people read those newspaper articles and they say, well, you know, scientists just can't agree on things. What good are they? And I think that really does have an impact. That does, in the long run, you know, makes people think, well, science isn't that useful. And unfortunately, it's useful. It's the most important tool we have to address, to shape how we're going to respond to these crises, not just COVID-19, but, you know, the climate crisis. You know, we've got a looming crisis of antibiotic-resistant bugs. There are lots of issues out there that we need good science, and it's an uphill battle right now.
If doubt has triumphed, as the title of your book suggests, what now?
Well, I don't think it's absolutely triumphed. I think that's a little hyperbole, but it certainly looks bleak right now. But, you know, I'm an optimist, and I think the political winds are going to shift. And I think in some ways we could think that President Trump has done us a favor. You know, the regulatory system, the public health system, was weak before President Trump came into office, but he certainly decimated it. But if you look at before he came into office, look at problems like Boeing 37 MAX. The FAA had really abdicated its responsibility for airline safety and let Boeing decide, you know, what's safe and what's not. FAA didn't have the resources, they didn't have the staff, and Boeing, given responsibility for safety, blew it. And two of those planes went down, killed hundreds of people, and now the entire industry and all air travelers are paying the price of that as well. We need to rebuild our regulatory system so it takes those things into account, that is truly independent and well enough resourced. So, you know, airplanes will be safe when, you know, we understand the toxic effects of chemicals, not by relying on research paid by industry, but that's done independently. And we make decisions on the best available evidence, acknowledging that we may not have all the evidence. It may not be totally clear, but we need to protect people immediately based on what we know, not say we need to do years more research until we're absolutely sure.
Well, thank you so much for talking with me. I really appreciate your time and your work.
Oh, my pleasure. Thanks for our conversation.
David Michaels is a professor at the George Washington University Milken Institute School of Public Health and author of The Triumph of Doubt, Dark Money, and the Science of Deception. Thanks for listening to Trump on Earth. If you like the podcast, please consider supporting us through Patreon. Just go to patreon.com/TrumpOnEarth. You can find us online at TrumpOnEarth.org and anywhere you get your podcasts. Write us a review and tell your friends. The podcast is supported by the Robert F. Schuman Foundation. Our producer and digital editor is Andy Kubis. Kathy Naur is the executive producer. I'm Kara Holsapple.